Okay, good morning, everybody. It's a great pleasure to introduce Dr. Sachin Vani from University of Colorado. We are here today to discuss about his article on how we do in our clinical practice about sampling patients with Barrett esophagus. So the title of your paper is "Endoscopists systematically undersample patients with long segment Barrett." So why did you think to that?
Yeah, I want to start off by one thanking you, Dr. Ribicci, and gastrointestinal endoscopy for this opportunity to talk about our research, and I represent all the co-authors on this paper. The reason why we felt that this was an important question is because this is one of the guidelines for management of patients with non-dysplastic Barrett's esophagus, which categorically state that you should be obtaining biopsies using the Seattle biopsy protocol, which is every 2 centimeters for patients with non-dysplastic Barrett's in a 4-quadrant fashion. Not only that, this has also been proposed as a quality indicator. So you should be meeting this benchmark in your clinical practice, which is obtaining biopsies using the Seattle biopsy protocol. Up until recently, we really had small studies that answered this question as to how well we're performing as endoscopists with regards to this quality indicator or this benchmark. So that's why we decided to proceed with this study using a large national benchmarking registry, which I'm sure we'll talk about.
Yeah, you mentioned about this registry. I think it's a very, very important. You reported very robust data to prove what you reporting in your paper. So can you tell us what was the methodology of the study? It's very important.
Yeah, no, absolutely. So we used the GI Quick Registry or the GI Quality Improvement Consortium. This really is a joint effort between the ACG and the ASGE to establish this quality registry. It primarily looks at upper endoscopies and colonoscopies. The best part about this benchmarking program is that it actually includes multiple practices all over the country, more than 200 practices that have actually contributed their data now, specifically with regards to upper endoscopy. And our goal was really to answer this basic question: how well are we doing as endoscopists with regards to obtaining biopsies using the Seattle biopsy protocol? The way we defined adherence was by actually dividing the length of the Barrett segment by the number of pathology jars that you submit to your pathologist, and we established a stringent definition and a lenient definition for overall adherence to this endpoint. And then we went a step further by not only providing these overall estimates for these two endpoints, but also provided the predictors associated with adherence to the Seattle biopsy protocol.
So this is very important because it means that you are giving us a sort of a real picture of the practice in this country, because you included a variety of institutions with different settings, from academic to non-academic.
Yep.
And can you tell us what was the result?
Yeah, so we actually looked at over 7,000 upper endoscopies to start with. That was our denominator. And then we had about 53,000 patients that underwent close to 59,000 upper endoscopies that actually met our inclusion criteria.
Sorry. So can we define what we consider a long segment?
Got it. So for one, initially our approach was to first identify all patients with Barrett's esophagus, and then we used the length of Barrett's as a continuous variable, and we categorized this using different categories of 0 to 4, 4 to 6, okay, and 6 to 8, and greater than 8 centimeters for our analysis. And moving on to our main results, what we showed was that when you used even a lenient definition of adherence, nearly 12% of patients who underwent endoscopies were not adherent to the Seattle biopsy protocol. But if you use a stringent definition, which I personally feel is what you should be using, that non-adherence rate is close to 20%. So just to summarize, 20% of overall endoscopies in patients with suspected Barrett's were non-adherent to the Seattle biopsy protocol. We then took it a step further to identify what are the factors that are associated with this non-adherence. And one of the most important risk factor was the length of the Barrett segment. And I will submit to you that we're not the first to show this. I think other investigators have also shown us that as the length of the Barrett segment increases, your non-compliance rate or your non-adherence rate increases. So that was one important finding. And then we also identified other factors such as age, gender, where you practice, the ASA class, which is a poor way to understand what the comorbidity index may be, were also factors associated with non-adherence to the Seattle biopsy protocol.
So it looks like you're expressing some concern about these results from a clinical standpoint, no?
Yeah, no, absolutely. I mean, I think if we want to provide the highest level of care to our patients and actually standardize the way we sample patients with Barrett's esophagus, I think it's important, at least as of now, until the field changes with regards to sampling techniques, whether it's artificial intelligence or use of other sampling techniques, I think we should all be sampling using the Seattle biopsy protocol.
You think that saying that we systematically undersample, we are risking not to identify subgroup of patients with dysplasia, they have increased risk of cancer?
Yeah, other investigators have shown that not sampling, especially for long segment Barrett's esophagus, will lead to a reduction in detection of dysplasia. So another reason why we should be sampling appropriately. And again, I think it's important for the audience to understand that with every 1 centimeter increase in the length, the odds of non-adherence increased by nearly 30%. So that's a telling result in my mind, at least from this analysis. And then it also brings us to this question about what is the ideal benchmark that you should be meeting in your practice. If you ask me, that benchmark should be 100%, but we understand that it's impossible.
No less than that.
But it's impossible to get to that number. So in my mind, it should be closer to 100%, recognizing that there may be some instances or individuals that you may not obtain biopsies using this protocol.
So let me thank you. This is very important. So it's also a very nice take-home message for our readers. Is there anything that we want to add on the top of these results and these conclusions?
No, I think there's several strengths to this analysis, as you brought up, that this really represents real-life data. This is what is happening in the United States. I'll actually go a step further, since these include data from gastroenterologists who are already participating in a quality benchmark. They may actually be doing better than some who are not even participating in a quality benchmarking program. So unfortunately, this may represent the best case scenario that we have in the United States. And I think the future lies in identifying what these barriers are, why are physicians not obtaining biopsies appropriately, and what can we do as people who care about these quality measures? Can we come up with intervention trials, education tools to ensure that we improve practice patterns in the United States?
Okay, thank you very much.